A big change for travelers after a judge strikes down the federal mask mandate. The TSA and many airlines no longer requiring face coverings, but some may still want to mask up. Medical editor Dr. Dave Hnida joins us now. And Dr. Dave, what's your advice when it comes to masks on planes or at airports now after this?
Well, this is kind of a tough one because, you know, we saw an awful lot of cheers when this decision came down, cheers and masks being flown off. But what we really didn't see were basically the fears and the tears. There's a lot of people who are really concerned about this ruling and how it came down. We have people who are immunocompromised. We have people with young children who can't be immunized yet or cannot wear a mask for their own self-protection. We have people who have underlying medical conditions, people over the age of 65. A lot of uncertainty for folks in terms of what their protections will actually be. Now, certainly, the thing we're hearing from public transportation officials is, well, masks are optional. And I think really what you see with that it is a situation where most people are just going to go without masks. There were three big problems with this decision that wound up coming out. The first was is that it really was a snap of the fingers type of decision. What was going on is the CDC was extending the mask mandate out until May the 3rd, until there really was a better sense of what is going on, especially with some of the new variants that we're seeing here in the country. Unfortunately, having the rug pulled out and just a sudden abrupt change left a lot of people unsure of just what was going to happen next. The other issue is the fact that this really was a judicial decision. This was not a health decision. This was not made by someone with a knowledge of healthcare. It was made by a judge without healthcare background or experience. And basically, it was a situation where someone literally used a dictionary in order to go through healthcare language in order to make decision striking down any mask mandates, not just on airplanes, but also in other forms of public transportation. The biggest and most worrisome thing with this, though, is the fact that there is the immediate concerns over people feeling protected. But really, there are longer term implications for this. Basically, this is a deal where, you know, the CDC and other agencies have been handcuffed for future issues. If there are surges in the future, if there is a different type of pandemic or new pandemics, if there's some other public health emergency like a bioterror incident or such, we really don't know who the heck is going to be calling the shots on this. Does everything need to go through the courts in order to get permission to enact any public health measures? We have a lot of people in the healthcare community who diplomatically have called this decision stupid. I think that I would call it dangerous, and certainly uncertainty is just really what's going through my head at a time like this.
And I know one of the things you mentioned was subvariants and variants. New York State health officials say they're seeing two new subvariants of the virus. What can you tell us about that?
Well, you know, welcome to the world of variants, subvariants, and subvariants of subvariants. Right now, you're hearing about a couple of subvariants of Omicron, which is going on mainly in the Northeast. This is a set of variants that were originally seen in Europe and have made their way to the United States. And we're trying to get a sense of what's going on with these variants. That was, once again, one of the reasons why the CDC wanted to hold on to mask mandates until we saw what these new variants wound up doing. The problem is, it's not just these subvariants that we're looking at right now, these viruses are constantly mutating. So not only do we have like, BA2 and BA1.21, we're also looking at things that are called BA3, BA4, BA5. These are things that are going on in Europe right now and will be making their way to the United States. And so we say, well, all right, we got these variants. What does it really mean from a practical standpoint? Well, the first thing we always ask is it more contagious than what we're dealing with right now? And the answer at this point appears to be yes, these are more contagious variants. The second concern is, are they more serious? Will they make you sicker? Will they put you in the hospital? This point, it doesn't appear to be that way, but we're just not sure. But nonetheless, there are important implications there when you think about it, because even if it doesn't land you in the hospital, if you get sick from getting one of these variants, it's going to knock you out of work. And so from an economic standpoint, small businesses, take a look at service workers, you look at airlines, are they going to be able to staff aircraft for travel over the summer? Once again, you may not be in the hospital, but certainly there will be an impact in terms of what it does to people and their ability to work. And so these are big concerns, too. We're having less ability to track these things because we're doing less testing, fewer vaccination sites. And so right now, basically with subvariants and the subvariants to come, it's like having a 200 mile an hour curveball being thrown at your head and you don't know which direction to move. And we certainly need to be nimble in terms of dealing with this, but you know, we really are having an increased inability to track these things because of funding and availability of services.
Interesting. And I'm excited to talk about this one. The FDA recently issued emergency use authorization for the COVID-19 breath test. Tell us a little bit about how that works, and do you think it might mean an end to nose swabs?
Yeah, you know, everybody's really saying, does this mean the end of brain swabs? Really, you know, it's an interesting product. It is from a company called Inspector, or Inspect IR. It basically is a suitcase size little analyzer. And what you do is you breathe through a small cardboard straw into this suitcase size analyzer. And what it does is it kind of comes up with a molecular footprint of whether or not COVID is present or not. And so the accuracy of this is pretty good. It's got emergency use authorization from the FDA. It's the first one to have it. And it looks like it's about 91-92% effective in terms of its accuracy, which is pretty good. And the downside, though, is the fact that you can't do a whole bunch of testing with this. It takes about 3 minutes to run a test, which sounds great, but that means you could do 20 tests per hour. So it's not really made for, you know, mass screening and give you an instant answer in terms of what's going on through there. The other thing, it needs to be done by a healthcare professional. And here's the kicker in this whole thing, is you think you're off the hook in terms of having to have any other swabbing done. The recommendation with this is going to be that if you wind up having a positive breath test, you need to go confirm it with a PCR test. So you're not totally off the hook. It's expected that this particular product will probably be available within the next 3 months for a little bit more public use. But I think the most exciting thing about this is the fact that they do have an accurate product. And I think it will just continue to advance in terms of what's capable in the future in terms of the ability to detect COVID more easily.
Yeah, it's interesting, and interesting to watch just how it's all kind of transformed over the past 2 years. So thanks so much, Dr. Dave. We really appreciate it.
You bet. Thank you.
Of course. And remember, you can check out all of Dr. Dave's segments right now on cbsdenver.com.